Dzień za dniem, noc za nocą. Nasze życie upływa pod bezkresnym niebem. Marzymy o rzeczach wielkich, ale życzymy sobie rzeczy prostych. Myślami wybiegamy do przodu, ale jesteśmy świadomi, że życie toczy się tu i teraz. Spoglądamy w niebo z dobrego miejsca na ziemi.
Lepiej tak, nie? Niż tam.
Potential investment in West Nusa Tenggara. Why? West Nusa Tenggara is ready to accept visitors and businesses? Fastest growing region in Indonesia. Consistently beats national economic growth in 2014 to 2017. GRDP growth of 25.3% from Q1 2014 to Q1 2018. The highest among 34 provinces. HDI index's growth of 8.9% from 2010 to 2017, the highest among 34 provinces. Solid infrastructure. 98% of national road is in solid category. Zainuddin Abdul Majid Airport. Revitalization of Badas and Bima ports. Gilimas, Lembar port development. Dams. Pandandur, Bintang Bano, Rababaka Complex. Surplus of 25 megawatt. Additional 450 megawatt is in development. Strong government support. Online and centralized permit and tracking system. Clear KPIs for investment permit processing. Principal permit, 3 days. Investment permit, 6 days. Capable workforce. Young, vibrant workforce. Workforce size 50% of total population. Low unemployment, 3.32%. Strong university networks. A total of 42 universities across the province. West Nusa Tenggara's diaspora network, national and international. West Nusa Tenggara scholarship for all degrees. Currently working with 26 universities in 5 countries around the globe.
Welcome to West Nusa Tenggara in Indonesia. As a governor, I have to make sure that our province is friendly to business community, friendly to investment. So we are so happy that you are interested to come to our province. Thank you very much.
Program zaprasza sponsor Miasto Toruń.
Witam serdecznie, mam nadzieję, że Państwo mnie słyszą. Prosiłabym tylko o informację zwrotną, czy mnie słychać.
Słychać.
Witam w imieniu organizatorów kongresu. Może poczekajmy jeszcze chwilę na Pana profesora. Może uda mu się z nami połączyć. Jeżeli nie, to wtedy może poprosiłabym Panią doktor Pietkiewicz Parek o poprowadzenie panelu, jeżeli pani się zgodzi na to.
Mogę poprowadzić, chociaż nigdy w życiu tego nie robiłam.
Dobrze, jeszcze chwilkę poczekajmy. Też mam informację, że pani Stanik trochę się spóźni z nami, ale ja jeszcze korzystając może z tego, że czekamy na pana profesora, w imieniu organizatorów chciałabym przedstawić państwu taką krótką informację dotyczącą informacji o patronach i sponsorach naszego kongresu. Także sponsorami strategicznymi 7. Międzynarodowego Kongresu Azjatyckiego są Urząd Marszałkowski Województwa Kujawsko-Pomorskiego, Ministerstwo Nauki i Szkolnictwa Wyższego w ramach programu Doskonała Nauka oraz Urząd Miasta Torunia. Wydarzenie odbywa się pod patronatem Ministerstwa Spraw Zagranicznych RP, Ministerstwa Nauki i Szkolnictwa Wyższego oraz Ministerstwa Rolnictwa i Rozwoju Wsi. Patronatem kongres objęli również marszałek województwa kujawsko-pomorskiego Piotr Całbecki, wojewoda kujawsko-pomorski Mikołaj Bogdanowicz, prezydent miasta Torunia Michał Zalecki i rektor Uniwersytetu Mikołaja Kopernika w Toruniu profesor doktor habilitowany Andrzej Sokala. Myślę, że poczekajmy jeszcze z 2 minutki, jeżeli nie, to po prostu przejdziemy do państwa prezentacji.
A czy ja mogę zadać pytanie odnośnie tego, do kiedy mamy przesyłać artykuły do druku?
Nie wiem, co na pewno po kongresie, to jeszcze będzie kilka czasu, po kongresie ten zespół organizacyjny prześle do państwa informacje z wszystkimi terminami. W tym momencie ciężko jest określić, ale myślę, że zaraz, za chwilkę po zamknięciu całego kongresu wszyscy uczestnicy otrzymają taką wiadomość. Dobrze, szanowni państwo. The panel should be in English, so maybe let's start in English. I would like to invite the PhD Beata Pietkiewicz-Parek for the first presentation.
Ja mam pytanie, a czy ja mogę zacząć, czy ja mogę w ogóle, ponieważ nikogo poza nami nie ma z zagranicy, czy mogłabym to po polsku przedstawić?
Wie pani co, wydaje mi się, że tak, ponieważ to pewnie decydowałby pan profesor Juszczyk, ale że właśnie skoro państwo są w takim gronie, to myślę, że nie będzie problemu.
Ponieważ ja bym chciała po prostu, może ja tu się, w takim razie bym chciała przeczytać po prostu to, co przygotowałam, dlatego że może zacznę od przedstawienia się. Nazywam się Beata Pietkiewicz-Parek. Skończyłam Uniwersytet Mikołaja Kopernika, gdzie robiłam doktorat, a w tej chwili pracuję na Uniwersytecie Wrocławskim na Wydziale Historii i Nauk Pedagogicznych. I nie ukrywam, że w momencie, kiedy się zapisywałam na konferencję, chciałam państwu przedstawić w bardzo pozytywnym świetle zjawisko e-learningu w Indiach. Natomiast to, co się wydarzyło przez ostatnich kilka miesięcy, pozwoliło mi absolutnie zmienić moje podejście do tego zagadnienia, w związku z czym przygotowałam zupełnie nowy artykuł, zupełnie inaczej chciałabym przedstawić po prostu ten problem, więc pozwolę go sobie po prostu przeczytać. Ze względu właśnie na zmiany, które wprowadziłam w moim postrzeganiu zdalnego nauczania w Indiach. Już przejdę do prezentacji. Distance learning in India, edukacja zdalna w Indiach. Pandemia COVID wymusiła na całym świecie zamknięcie szkół i reorganizację tradycyjnego szkolnictwa. Nigdy w historii edukacji nie mieliśmy do czynienia z masowym zamknięciem szkół i przejściem na zdalną edukację. Nigdy w historii nie byliśmy zmuszeni do niewychodzenia z domu, zaprzestania spotykania się z rodziną, przyjaciółmi, a nawet najbliższymi sąsiadami. Nowa sytuacja zmusiła nas do podjęcia nowych działań, do zastanowienia się nad tym, jak edukacja w okresie pandemii ma wyglądać. Jak dotąd nikt nie przygotował nas na to wyzwanie, dlatego społeczność akademicka na całym świecie musi zmierzyć się z tym problemem i wypracować nowe standardy dla zdalnej edukacji. Nie jest to łatwe bez bezpośredniego kontaktu dziecka z nauczycielem, bez dostępu do internetu, komputera, czy nawet bez dostępu do prądu. Jednym z krajów najbardziej dotkniętych koronawirusem są Indie. Plasuje je to na drugim miejscu pod względem zachorowalności na COVID na świecie, zaraz po Stanach Zjednoczonych. Artykuł ten przybliża polskiemu czytelnikowi sytuację w szkolnictwie indyjskim w okresie pandemii. Ukazuje walkę Hindusów z ograniczeniami takimi jak niemożność nawiązania bezpośredniego kontaktu nauczyciela z uczniem, braku dostępu do internetu, braku dostępu do bibliotek i pomocy naukowych, brak dostępu do szkolnej infrastruktury, a także niemożności korzystania z bezpośredniej pomocy rówieśników. Rząd Indii stara się ulepszyć istniejące programy, a także stworzyć programy bazujące na zasobach dostępnych najbiedniejszym mieszkańcom Indii, by uniknąć sytuacji, gdy dzieci rezygnują z nauki i różnice między bogatymi a biednymi jeszcze bardziej się uwidaczniają. W Indiach ponad 320 milionów uczniów zostało zmuszonych do pozostania w domu po tym, jak rząd ogłosił zamknięcie szkół związane z pandemią roku. Natychmiast zaczęto organizować zajęcia zdalne, zapominając, że większość obywateli nie ma dostępu do internetu, a nawet i prądu, nie wspominając, że posiadanie komputera jest dla nich nieosiągalnym marzeniem. Zgodnie z danymi z lipca 2020 roku, zaledwie 50% mieszkańców Indii miało dostęp do internetu, co oznacza, że na ponad miliard ludzi tylko 560 milionów ma dostęp do internetu. Jest to znaczący progres, jeżeli weźmiemy pod uwagę fakt, iż w 2007 roku zaledwie 4% mieszkańców miało dostęp do internetu. Dostęp do internetu w Indiach jest uzależniony od takich czynników jak płeć czy status społeczny. W 2019 roku 290 milionów użytkowników pochodziło z rejonów wiejskich, a 337 milionów z rejonów miejskich. Większość z użytkowników to ludzie pomiędzy 20 a 29 rokiem życia. Logowali się głównie z telefonów komórkowych. Możliwość korzystania z taniego internetu jest zasługą m.in. kampanii Digital India, której celem jest dostarczenie internetu 4G do wszystkich wiejskich regionów Indii. Facebook jest najpopularniejszym medium społecznościowym w Indiach, liczącym ponad 280 milionów użytkowników. Tworzenie programów do zdalnego nauczania wymaga czasu, specjalistów i zazwyczaj pewnych nakładów finansowych. Instytucje edukacyjne, które do tej pory prowadziły zajęcia zdalne, są przygotowane na czas pandemii, by kontynuować swoją pracę. W gorszym położeniu znalazły się te placówki, które do tej pory nigdy nie miały do czynienia z edukacją zdalną na masową skalę, a nauczyciele nie są wyposażeni w najnowszy sprzęt do prowadzenia zajęć online. W chwili obecnej Indie muszą się zmierzyć z trzema wyzwaniami, by zapewnić ciągłość edukacji. Po pierwsze, edukacja to proces ciągły. By zdobyć wiedzę, uczeń musi najpierw zaliczyć jeden rozdział, potem drugi i tak dalej. Nie można niczego przeskoczyć czy pominąć. Po drugie, muszą zapewnić wszystkim uczniom dostęp do materiałów, z których mają korzystać. Żaden uczeń nie może zostać pominięty w dostępie do edukacji. Nie każdy musi mieć zajęcia online, ale każdy musi mieć książki, zeszyty czy inne materiały, które często zostały w szkole, kiedy te zostały z dnia na dzień zamknięte. Po trzecie i chyba najważniejsze, należy mieć na uwadze dobrostan dziecka. Izolacja, brak kontaktu z rówieśnikami czy rodziną negatywnie wpływają na dzieci. W trudnych czasach wszyscy powinni o tym pamiętać. Do najpopularniejszych platform wykorzystywanych przez indyjskich nauczycieli w edukacji zdalnej zaliczyć można Zoom i Microsoft Teams. Jednakże, jak nauczyciele sami przyznają, nie każdy uczeń ma konto mailowe, w związku z czym korzystają z darmowej wersji Zoom. Nauczyciel tworzy wydarzenie i zaprasza do niego uczniów, wysyłając im hasło do spotkania. Nauczanie asynchroniczne daje zaś nauczycielowi możliwość przygotowania materiału i przysłania go w dogodnym dla siebie czasie, natomiast uczniom rozwiązywanie zadań wtedy, kiedy mają czas. Daje zarówno to nauczycielowi, jak i uczniom swobodę pracy nad nowym materiałem. I teraz przedstawię aplikacje online na indyjskim rynku edukacyjnym, które są dostępne właśnie od czasów pandemii. W celu zaangażowania nauczycieli w walkę z pandemią koronawirusa, rząd Indii uruchomił platformę iGOT z modułem szkoleniowym o nazwie Zintegrowane Rządowe Szkolenie Online dla Pracowników Rządowych. Celem programu jest zwiększenie zdolności pracowników do skutecznego radzenia sobie z pandemią COVID-19. Kursy uruchomiono nie tylko dla nauczycieli, ale również dla lekarzy, pielęgniarek, funkcjonariuszy rządu stanowego, urzędników, policji, wolontariuszy i innych ludzi z pierwszej linii walki z koronawirusem. Platforma ma za zadanie szkolenie nauczycieli online, przygotowanie ich do prowadzenia zdalnej edukacji, przygotowywania quizów, wykonywania zajęć edukacyjnych w celu promowania kreatywności i krytycznego myślenia, a przede wszystkim w celu zapewnienia ciągłości nauczania związanego z realizacją programu nauczania w obecnych czasach. Materiały edukacyjne na portalu można uzyskać po zalogowaniu się na platformę, wykorzystując jedynie telefon komórkowy. I kolejny program, SMILE Program Rajasthan Online Education Program. Platforma SMILE Social Media Interface for Learning Engagement to innowacyjny program Departamentu Edukacji Szkolnej w Rajasthanie, którego celem jest zapewnienie edukacji zdalnej uczniom pozostającym w domu na skutek wybuchu pandemii koronawirusa. Rada Gminy Lub Sołtys, tak zwany Gram Panchayat, otrzymuje wybrane materiały edukacyjne, które następnie przekazywane są rodzicom uczniów. Program SMILE efektywnie wykorzystuje także media społecznościowe i aplikację WhatsApp na niespotykaną dotąd skalę. Umożliwiają one kontakt z rodzicami i wieloaspektowy rozwój uczniów zamkniętych w domu na skutek pandemii. Ważną rolę w dystrybucji materiałów edukacyjnych pełni administrator, czyli urzędnik w Radzie Gminy, gdyż to właśnie on jest odpowiedzialny za przekazywanie materiałów edukacyjnych za pośrednictwem aplikacji WhatsApp. W tym celu utworzono dwie grupy odbiorców pomocy edukacyjnych, nauczycieli i rodziców. Rodzice odgrywają bardzo ważną rolę w programie SMILE, gdyż to właśnie oni muszą przekazać materiały otrzymane na telefon komórkowy swoim dzieciom. Dzięki temu mają świadomość, jakie treści codziennie dostają ich dzieci, mogą ingerować w ich naukę w domu, kontrolować ich postępy, a także poszerzyć swoją wiedzę o nowe wiadomości. Obecnie materiały edukacyjne tworzone i wybierane są w kontekście stanowym, a w przyszłości będą opracowywane w oparciu o państwowe programy nauczania. Nauczyciele są aktywnym partnerem w procesie tworzenia materiałów edukacyjnych. Ich rolą jest aktywna pomoc uczniom, obserwacja, analiza ich postępów w samodzielnym zdobywaniu wiedzy. Przygotowują i wysyłają również własne materiały rodzicom, jak również nagrywają własne filmiki i wideo. Dzięki skutecznej realizacji programu SMILE Rajasthan ma szansę odnieść ogromne korzyści w zapewnieniu uczniom kształcenia w czasach pandemii. I teraz chciałabym chwilę porozmawiać o wykluczeniu cyfrowym. Główne wady nauczania zdalnego to brak odpowiedniego sprzętu. W skrajnych przypadkach uczeń może nie mieć dostępu do żadnego urządzenia pozwalającego na zdalny udział w lekcji lub pracy z zasobami cyfrowymi. W wielu przypadkach nie ma swobodnego na wyłączność dostępu do sprzętu lub ten, który jest w gospodarstwie domowym, musi być współdzielony przez większą liczbę osób z rodzeństwem lub rodzicami. Brak kamery internetowej oznacza brak możliwości udziału w telekonferencji. Brak drukarki oznacza brak możliwości drukowania materiałów. Dostęp jedynie do smartfona pozwala na udział w zdalnych lekcjach, ale tylko w sposób ograniczony, znacząco utrudnia pracę z zasobami cyfrowymi. Problemy lub ograniczenia dostępu do internetu występują w wielu gospodarstwach domowych. W wielu miejscach, szczególnie na obszarach wiejskich, jakość połączenia może nie być wystarczająca, by uczestniczyć w niektórych formach zdalnej edukacji, szczególnie w telekonferencjach. W skrajnych przypadkach uczeń może nie mieć jakiegokolwiek dostępu do internetu. Część uczniów ma dostęp do internetu jedynie poprzez urządzenie mobilne, w przypadku których może się pojawiać problem limitu wykorzystanych danych. Problemem odpowiednich kompetencji dotyczy szczególnie nauczycieli i rodziców dzieci młodszych, które potrzebują pomocy w obsługiwaniu technologii. Dotyczą m.in. umiejętności korzystania z narzędzi do zdalnego połączenia, umiejętności pracy z usługami i zasobami cyfrowymi, umiejętności pracy zespołowej i samodzielnej w modelu zdalnym, umiejętności tworzenia materiałów i scenariuszy lekcji w innej metodyce. Większość osób nigdy nie korzystała z rozwiązań e-learningowych, zarówno synchronicznych oraz narzędzi edukacji asynchronicznej. Warunki mieszkaniowe, takie jak wielkość mieszkania, liczba pomieszczeń, liczba domowników, możliwość wyjścia na świeże powietrze, również warunkują udział w edukacji zdalnej. Ta forma wykluczenia wykracza poza tradycyjne rozumienie wykluczenia cyfrowego, jest jednak czynnikiem, który będzie znacząco wpływał na możliwość realizacji edukacji zdalnej. W domach, w których na ograniczonej powierzchni przebywa wiele osób, może nie być warunków do udziału w lekcjach zdalnych, szczególnie przez dłuższy czas. Problemem może być nawet praca samodzielna w komfortowych warunkach. Rodzice łączący obowiązki zawodowe i rodzicielskie mogą nie mieć możliwości odpowiedniego wsparcia w procesie edukacyjnym. Wielu uczniów ma specjalne potrzeby edukacyjne i potrzebuje zasobów spełniających wymogi dostępności, przystosowanych do potrzeb uczniów słabowidzących, niewidomych, słabosłyszących i głuchych. Włączenie w edukację zdalną uczniów o specjalnych potrzebach będzie wymagało specjalnych działań i odpowiednio dostosowanych usług i zasobów. Systemy pomocowe w Indiach obecnie są w stanie rozpoznać osoby wykluczone cyfrowo poprzez cyfrowe rejestry identyfikacji oparte na biometrii. W kraju od kilku lat wdraża się system cyfrowej tożsamości ADAR, który umożliwia dotarcie poprzez smartfony do ponad miliarda osób, co ma szczególne znaczenie na obszarach wiejskich. Dzięki temu ponad 50% Hindusów ma możliwość skorzystania ze świadczeń pomocowych. Przyspieszona wskutek pandemii digitalizacja czyni dostęp do internetu jednym z dóbr podstawowych i niedługo może zostać zaliczona do istotnych praw człowieka. UNESCO i ITU, Międzynarodowa Unia Telekomunikacyjna będąca agendą ONZ, powołała do życia Komisję Zrównoważonego Rozwoju Szerokopasmowego Internetu, której celem jest podłączenie do sieci 75% globalnej populacji do roku 2025. Jednakże bez umiejętności wykorzystania internetu, umiejętności cyfrowe staną się jednym z kluczowych czynników polaryzacji na świecie. Dziękuję.
Dziękuję bardzo. Do we have any questions? Nie. Dobrze, oddaję głos panu Janowi. Czy jest pan z nami?
Tak jest, dzień dobry.
Dobry.
Ja myślę, że powinienem w sumie najpierw wyjaśnić w ogóle swój temat, ponieważ on nie do końca chyba się wpisuje w problematykę tej konferencji, natomiast ja go zgłosiłem jeszcze w ubiegłym roku do konferencji, która też miała się odbyć w Toruniu, o świecie islamu, no ale niestety ta konferencja się nie odbyła i problem polega na tym, że tekst już swój zgłosiłem do publikacji pokonferencyjnej. Natomiast pan Michał Dar, który był tam osobą odpowiedzialną za tą konferencję, dał nam taką możliwość, żeby po prostu zgłosić się na konferencję do Kongresu Azjatyckiego, w związku z czym na tą zgłosiłem się i ten temat dzisiaj o Turcji będę Państwu prezentował i od razu mam kolejną pytanie, wątpliwość, ponieważ ja mam prezentację do tego swojego wykładu, tylko że ona jest już przygotowana po angielsku. I czy ja ją mam w ogóle Państwa
zdaniem? Tak. I jak jest taka możliwość, to też prosiłabym, żeby Pan ją prezentował w języku angielskim.
O, super, okej. Dobrze, to już. Dobra. Czy ona jest dla Państwa widoczna?
Tak, widzimy.
Okej, super. Dobrze. Good afternoon. Again, my name is Jan Niemiec and I am PhD candidate at the Department of National Security of the Jagiellonian University in Krakow. As we can see, the thematic scope of my presentation focuses on Turkish Directorate of Religious Affairs, which is also known as Diyanet in Turkish, and its significant role in the foreign policy of the Republic of Turkey. First, let me give you a short outline of my presentation. So after this technical and methodological aspects of my research, I will briefly describe the conception of secularism in Turkey. Then, in historical approach, of course, I will introduce the Directorate of Religious Affairs as institution responsible for determining the state's religious policy. And in that part, I will pay special attention to Diyanet's activities during the rule of the Justice and Development Party and its international importance as a public diplomacy organization. And finally, the presentation concludes with a set of final remarks and implications for Turkish foreign policy. So as a theoretical basis for my research, I adopted the image theory in international relations, which is very useful in exploring a policymaking process. According to its assumptions, image theory examines foreign policy of a given state in relation to its internal and international images, which are created by decision makers. Moreover, political perceptions are often shaped by a social mood and preferences of the voters. So if politicians can properly combine these individual images into a coherent whole, their diplomatic activities might improve international position of a state. In other words, any international action of a state should be taken with an idea to create a positive image of itself. But on the other hand, the general image is also influenced by external perception, that is opinions and views expressed by others participants of international system. And collectively, all these images define the position of a given state and determine its capabilities and limitations in relation to others. And in order to identify the most significant factors related to the development of directorate or, as a key institution in administrative structure, a whole variety of Turkish sources was examined. And therefore I chose source criticism as a basic research method. And consequently, I formulated the main research hypothesis that this strong international position of the Directorate of Religious Affairs results from the emphasis put on religious factor by Turkish foreign policymakers in 21st century. If you want to address the problem of contemporary understanding of secularism in Turkey, I think we must go back to the very origins of Turkish statehood. Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, so the founder of modern Turkey, saw religion as a part of the legacy of Ottoman Empire that needed to be removed from the public. Although Islam was an indelible part of Turkish identity for actually most citizens, and the political elite ultimately decided to declare Turkey a secular state in 1937. However, secularism on Turkish grounds is understood much differently than in Europe. So not as a separation of religion from the state and civic affairs, but rather as a state's control over religion. So it can be said that the peculiar program of religious interventionism was created in Turkey, which was then imposed on the citizens. And according to its assumptions, Islam was to be an individual practice of believers, but determined top down by the state authorities. And the institution that was supposed to be responsible for managing religion on behalf of the state authorities was Directorate of Religious Affairs, which was established in 1924 by Grand National Assembly of Turkey. In order to deprive the annex of any political autonomy, the institution was directly subordinated to the office of a prime minister. And therefore, Directorate was to function as a highly dependent public service with a low rank in administrative structures and a relatively narrow scope of duties. Over the time, its range of influence grew as the authorities decided to use the institution to promote among citizens the state version of moderate Islam. As a result of the directorate's activity, its, let's say, prestige was also strengthened, especially in the countryside. And taking advantage of this process, the government began to incorporate religious aspects into its politics. And for example, the UNIT's cooperation with the authorities resulted in the restoration of religious education in Turkey in 1948. The UNIT's position within the state apparatus grew after the military coup in 1960, when the army employed this institution to consolidate a divided society. Under a new constitution, the directorate became a special body for determining the state's religious policy. One of the UNIT's main tasks at that time was to inform the public about the moral principles of Islam. Fighting against communist sentiments in Turkey, the authorities commissioned the directorate to enlighten the society, and the purpose of which was to stop influx of leftist ideologies. Consequently, Diyanet gained subjectivity and ability to influence other areas of the state in terms of education, culture, and social policy. In the following years, Diyanet was obliged to strengthen national unity and solidarity by combining Islamic traditions with nationalist values. In order to perform these additional tasks, Diyanet was equipped by the government with new tools that further improved its administrative position. But however, Diyanet's greater autonomy did not affect religious freedoms in Turkey, as only the official version of Islam was still promoted. The international chapter in the activities of the directorate began with the establishment of General Directorate of Foreign Relations in 1971. Outside Turkey, Diyanet aimed to ensure the coordination of religious support for Turkish diaspora in Western Europe. Under many bilateral agreements with European countries, employees of the directorate worked at embassies of the Republic as special officials of the diplomatic service with the status of religious advisors. Some Western countries had chosen Diyanet as a result of integration problems with Turkish migrants, as well as to oppose radical streams of Islam, for example, Salafism and so on. The main tasks of the directorate were provision of religious services, promotion of Turkish version of Sunni Islam, organization of meetings for Muslim communities, and popularization of publication on religious topics among the believers. At the turn of the 70s and 80s, the directorate established a regional association in Austria, Germany, and the Netherlands, and later opened into its local branches also in France, Switzerland, and in Belgium. The victory of Justice and Development Party, it's Adalet ve Kalkınma Partisi in Turkey, so it's AKP. So the victory of the AKP in the 2002 parliamentary elections initiated the process of restoring the importance of religion in Turkish public life. The party leaders had a conservative background, so they sought to recreate the true Islamic identity of the Turks. And almost from the very beginning, the government's plan for the re-Islamization was supported by the directorate, which became a key institution within the state apparatus under the AKP's rule. It's worth mentioning that between 2002 and 2010, its budget and staff increased fivefold. As a result, DNS activities became fully adapted to the political strategy of the ruling party. And intention of the AKP was to integrate various social groups around religion. For example, after changes in constitution in 2010, the institution was given a ministerial rank, and Mehmet Görmez, who was associated with the AKP, was appointed its new chairman. Well, since then, the directorate has functioned essentially as an executor of the interest of the AKP, and its activities have been kind of synchronized with the politics of Ankara. And of course, the ideological transformation of the state also included diplomacy, because by changing the doctrine of Turkish foreign policy, the authorities gave priority to relations with Muslim states, and therefore Islam has become one of the basic tools in the government's new strategy. And through numerous references to religious and cultural community, Turkey was aiming at improve its image among neighbors and achieve the status of regional power. Since religion was used in the plan for political expansion, the directorate was transformed into the flagship institution of Turkish public diplomacy, whose task was to transmit norms and values promoted by the AKP. Basically, Diyanet's international activities have been twofold, as the official representative of state authorities and through its local offices. And because of this, a fairly coherent message was created for the Muslims worldwide. In Turkish discourse, the Islamic internationalism proposed by the AKP is intended to contribute to the broadly understood development in all countries of the region. For example, Diyanet's Eurasian Islamic Council serves as a platform for cooperation between Muslim states on issues such as religious practices, Quranic education, and contemporary problems. So for example, Islamophobia, extremism, etc. So as we can see, Diyanet attempts to become a point of reference for the entire community, being the leading Islamic transnational organization in the world. So as the central institution for Turkish public diplomacy, currently the directorate has 61 branches in 36 countries. Diyanet's operating model is based on three main directions. So the first one is Turkish diaspora in Western Europe and North America. The second is Turkic peoples in Balkans, in the Caucasus, and in Central Asia, and the rest of the world, especially in the Middle East and North Africa. Although Diyanet's basic tasks have not changed that much since the mid-70s, their scale and their impact have definitely increased. And my responsibilities of the institution include providing a wide range of religious services, popularizing knowledge about Islam, providing Islamic education, financing the construction on and renovation of mosques, and delegating imams and other religious officials, and so on. And so forth. Today, Diyanet's position is particularly strong in Western Europe and in the Balkans, where it is recognized as the biggest Muslim organization. However, some activities of the directorate have sparked great controversy in recent years. First, implementation of the AKP's identity policy is often associated with promoting anti-European attitudes, which sometimes even lead to political conflicts. For example, in the Balkans, the Turks strongly promote the model of cooperation, which is based on imperial past, and it is related to the ideology of neo-Ottomanism. Although governments of countries in the region recognize some aspects of Diana's activities as an attempt to, let's say, subordinate the Balkans to the Turkey, some local communities fully support this AKP identity policy. And important in this context is that Diana's activities are based on bilateral agreements concluded in the 70s, which cannot be changed without Turkey's consent. And therefore, Turkey maintains a strong position, for example, in the field of Quranic education in Europe. And recently, some criticism has also been raised about the low competences of Turkish religious officials who engage in political agitation among Muslims, but do not know the realities or the language of the host countries. And yet another interesting aspect of the activity of the Directorate in Europe was revealed after the failed military coup in July 2016, when its employees, on the orders of President Erdogan, of course, collected information about people suspected of having links with the alleged coup plotters. As a result, Austria, Germany, Switzerland, and I think the Netherlands too, all of these countries accused dozens of religious officials affiliated with local Diyanet branches of espionage and expelled them from their countries. So overall, it can be said that the Diyanet currently functions mainly as a tool for mobilizing the electorate in line with Erdogan's intentions, neglecting the religious aspect itself. Okay, so summing up the briefly story about the Diyanet, I should first of all refer to the theoretical framework we mentioned at the beginning. The change in Turkey's international image initiated at the by the AKP and President Erdogan was certainly affected by expectation of part of Turkish society. According to AKP politicians, ideological transformation of the state and restoration of its religious identity contributed to the improvement of Turkish regional position. By exposing the role of religion in foreign policy, the authorities directed their message mainly to the Muslim community, hoping to achieve the status of regional leader, and therefore making Diyanet a leading transnational religious organization strengthened the image of Turkey, which was created by Turkish political elites. And of course, there are a number of positive aspects related to Diyanet's activities. For example, fight against Muslim extremism, the renovation of historic mosques, and many educational and social programs. But on the other hand, Diyanet's growing involvement in the political sphere is met with opposition from authorities in host countries. In particular, and there is a disapproval towards attempts to pursue the interest of the AKP by institution that officially focuses only on religious cooperation. But nevertheless, despite those several doubts, instrumental use of religion can be considered a completely correct and completely rational political conception. Because after all, as we can see, renewed Islamic identity and references to imperial legacy allow Turks to conduct more expansive policy in the region. Therefore, I think that the role of Diyanet for Turkish diplomacy is extremely important, as through this institution, the AKP can freely use the religious component to influence the internal situation in many countries. So there is no doubt that the role of the Directorate of Religious Affairs in the foreign policy of President Erdogan and his party will continue to grow. But the question that remains, however, is whether Turkey will adapt its Islamic rhetorics to new challenges and gain, in consequence, global support among Muslims. But I will not answer this question today. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much for your presentation. It was really, really interesting. As I saw, now it's time for Ms. Stanek. As I see, you are with us.
Yes, yes, right? Yes, I am with you, but please excuse me for the lack of video because I'm still at work and that is at school. And unfortunately, we are having a lot of technical problems. And unfortunately, I'm afraid that I get disconnected at some point because we still have got hundreds and hundreds of students who are connected through the school internet system. So I hope you don't mind. Should I start already or?
Yeah, please.
Okay, I have got a presentation already, so let me launch it. And I really hope that I'm not going to get disconnected at some point. We are using Microsoft Teams. I mean, all of us, the whole of Warsaw, and so Zoom should be pretty much Zoom should be fine. However, you never know. Let me just find share now. Yes, here we are. I hope you can see the presentation. I think this one will be a bit nicer for you to look at. I'm going to improvise a little bit since I forgot my notes as well. So basically I'm kind of unprepared today, but I hope I'll kind of get you into the topic and I'll get you interested in the Indo-Polish relationships during the Second World War, which is the main topic of my PhD thesis that I'm hoping to complete at some point in the future. The title of my presentation is Martial Race Theory in the Representation of the South Asian Other in Polish World War II account. So as you can imagine, I'm going to be talking about some kind of literary analysis. So a little bit different, I guess, from what we've had so far, but I hope you will stay interested. Before I move on to the actual presentation, let me quickly guide you through what you're going to be seeing on your screen. First, I'm going to briefly introduce the study itself. Then I'm going to talk briefly also about the martial race theory. Then we will look at encountering the other. So at the moments and places in history where the encounters could have happened, and they did happen. And then I'm going to tell you briefly about the image of the Gurkhas and the Indians in the Polish World War II memoirs, and that is going to take us straight to the conclusion part. And so starting with the study, my study concerns, the main research material is basically Polish World War II memoirs. I have gone through hundreds of them. They are really many. And I found references to Indians and to Gurkha, meaning Nepalese soldiers in the British Army, in about one third of the whole batch, I think. So perhaps about, I don't know, 30 or something contains any references in total to the Indians. So in spite of the fact that our soldiers and Indian soldiers and the Nepalese soldiers served alongside each other during the Second World War, they did not really leave many accounts of these encounters, which is kind of disappointing from my perspective, but I'm glad I found anything at all. I'm going to be looking into memoirs published both in Polish and in English, because some authors after the war decided to stay in the UK. They did not want to return, or they couldn't return to Poland after 1945. So they decided to publish their memoirs in English. and I also take them into consideration. And basically the study sort of critically examines the selected bits and pieces that that I pull out of these memoirs. The main lens that I've been using is the postcolonial lens, but I found it interesting to sort of develop the point of the martial race theory itself. So this is a sort of branch of the whole study, a tiny little study and a tiny little lens. That is only a part of the whole research. So for the purpose of today's presentation, I'm going to focus on the martial race, omitting the postcolonial lens. And here on the right, we can see the definition of Minisami memoirs, so the ones that I take into consideration, but I think this is nothing strange for you, and I guess we can move on at this stage. So in order to introduce you briefly to the martial race theory itself, as you can see, it's sort of linked to imperial masculinity. Of course, we are sort of moving backwards to the 19th century and the earlier 20th century, because right now you can't really imagine, I guess, that martial race theory is something that that would be present in today's discourse. However, if you really want to get the feeling, you can Google the Gurkhas, and I think all the results that are going to pop up on your screen are basically sort of related to the martial race theory, because the Gurkhas are still perceived through that lens, which is kind of interesting. So they are seen still as sort of warriors naturally predisposed to war. And that martial race theory basically sees some groups of men who are, for cultural or biological reasons, better at soldiering than others. Some populations, according to that theory, they produce superior soldiers. And it was more, at its most influential between the First World War and the end of the 19th century. And you could encounter it in the imperial countries, and mostly in the British Empire and India, even though some elements of it were still present at the beginning of the 20th century in other imperial countries. So France, I think, they did have some martial ideas in place also before the First World War. Yeah, I think France, and nothing else comes to my mind. But if you have a look at the list of the martial soldiers, you can see the Bedouins, the Zulu, Scottish Highlanders, the Irish even at some point appeared there as well, according to some scholars. So Punjabi Sikhs, of course, Nepalese Gurkhas, and Afghan and Indonesian ethnic groups as well. And what was the martial race theory used for? Well, it was used in the processes of constructing recruiting policies. How come? Well, the connection between the British Empire and the Raj was basically sort of based on the military, British military presence on the Indian subcontinent. So because there were not so many like European soldiers in India at that stage, the composition of the army was basically consisting of Indians themselves. Now, 1857, so the Indian mutiny or rebellion, whatever kind of sources you are going to look at, the names for that event would be different depending whether you're using the Indian discourse or the British discourse. However, what we mean is that event that shaped the Raj. So before 1857, the composition of the Indian army was basically Bengal and lower Indian ethnic groups. And then what we had after 1857, we had mostly the Sikhs and the Gurkhas. So what happened? There was a sort of gradual replacement of, if I may put it in that sort of not very nice way, of some ethnic groups with others from that moment on. And by the First World War, 57% of the soldiers were of martial background. And the idea was also closely linked to the notion of loyalty to the Europeans, even though this kind of disloyalty is being discussed mostly with regards to the Indians and not to the Gurkhas, as my research has proved. The scientific justification was that those men were most manly, trustworthy, and they possessed warrior masculinity, whatever that means. There are some nice studies on that. The topic is still being developed, so I believe that in the next couple of years we are going to see some nice studies on the martial race theory. It's been around for about 10 to 20 years, so it's a relatively new topic that is being discussed by academics. Basically, what academics have concluded so far, that the theory was used to articulate ideal characteristics of colonial populations and as a tool of exclusions. As we could see, some groups were excluded from the participation in the army based on their, let's put it this way, natural capabilities with regards to war and warfare in general. So moving on to the core of my research, to what extent was the theory present in the Polish experience of the Second World War? Before I look into that, I would like you to place yourselves on the map and see where these encounters had actually happened. So the main meeting points, as far as I was able to establish, were firstly, during training and pay force duties in Iraq and Persia to base Iran, because Polish soldiers after the evacuation, we are talking about a group that was evacuated from the Soviet Union in 1942. So in order to get better, in order to get trained, they spent some time in the Middle East where they were undergoing training, and there were also some Indian troops as well, parts of the Indian army who were there basically to guard the oil fields against the Germans. They were afraid that Germans arrived there and that they take over the oil fields. So there was a whole bunch of the Indian army, and the Poles had some training and some duties alongside with them. Then the other meeting points, the main meeting point was, of course, the Italian campaign. So in Italy, 1945, we had both the Indians, the Indian army, and the Poles, as all of you know. And then some minor encounters also happened in North Africa. And after the evacuation from the Soviet Union, what I mean in here, I mean the encounters that were not strictly military, because at first when the Poles were evacuated, they needed some time to recover, and they met Indians, Indian soldiers who helped them around the camp where they were based. So they were a sort of first line of contact, but no military duties at that stage were involved. They were not involved in any military duties at that stage. So now if we look at the image of the Gurkhas in the material that I have analyzed, they appear in military context only. So we see them only as soldiers. They don't appear in any other roles. So they are not cooking, they are not cleaning, they are not driving. No, they are soldiers. And I think this is crucial in the building of the image of the Gurkhas, because basically this builds a sort of image of the Gurkhas as really, really martial soldiers, because they do anything else, they just fight, right? So this is something that we could see in the Polish memoirs that I find fascinating. Then they are portrayed as soldiers from the Himalaya region. The Polish authors are not exactly sure where the Gurkhas come from, but most of them are able to place them correctly in the Himalaya region. So there is one author who rightly says that that the Gurkhas are from Nepal, but northern India, I think, also appears as one of the options, and Tibet as another option. So there is a little bit of confusion. They are portrayed as skilled in warfare, dangerous professional. There is no mention of loyalty. So they are perceived a little bit differently from the Indians in this respect, because this loyalty does not really play any role. And this is what makes their image different from the British image of the Gurkhas, because in the British discourse, they are being portrayed mostly through the lens of loyalty, because they are still serving in the British Army. So even though Nepal was never a British colony and the Britons are not present in Asia anymore, the Gurkhas are still there. And they are still, as of 2020, they are still portrayed as loyal army intakes, loyal to the British Army, loyal to the Queen, and loyal to Britain, basically. And what is also interesting in the image of the Gurkhas is that there is no mutual exchange between the Gurkhas and the Poles, so they are never portrayed speaking to each other. And also this is a difference when it comes to the image of the Indians, because it often happens that they do together something with Indians, but they don't do anything with the Gurkhas. So my question is, why are the Gurkhas so unapproachable? And I think this also has something to do with their extreme professionalism when it comes to war. It seems that the Polish authors are really, really happy that they don't have to fight the Gurkhas, that Gurkhas are not their enemies, but they know there is a sort of superiority aura when it comes to their image, that they don't want to approach them. They are simply, at some point, I even think that they may be afraid of them. But this is just my idea and speculation. Here you have got on the right, you can see a quote from a memoir by Tadeusz Bodnar. Bodnar really paid a lot of attention to the Gurkhas in his memoir. It's a fascinating account. There are many, many nice excerpts of that from that memoir regarding the Gurkhas. He seems to be really interested, and I'm very, very happy that I found that memoir early during my research. So the quote is, "We walked very slowly because of the tree roots sticking out of the ground. Every now and then someone got caught in them and fell into a mine crater. We had to watch for mines and booby traps. The Gurkha soldier must have had the tiger's eyes as he moved like a tiger, not even once falling or tripping over the roots." So this is just one of the bits, but it shows you how the Gurkhas were superior. They could even see something during the night, and it was just them, only them, who were able to win over that situation. There is another one, an excerpt from the memoir of Aleksander Gorbicki. "As I'm walking along Cavendish Road, I see inky caves with German soldiers' legs sticking out of them. All around there are remains of the English, the New Zealanders, and of the tiny but brave Gurkhas." And that adjective brave also appears in other memoirs. So this is something that they really are, the characteristic that they really associate with the Gurkhas. And now moving on to the Indians, we can't find as many descriptions, especially regarding bravery and loyalty also. What characterizes the image of the Indians in the Polish World War II memoirs? There is no distinction between the diverse people of India. So the only exception is one reference to the Sikhs. And apart from that is just Indians. So that makes it complicated to sort of look at their image through the martial race theory, because it seems that the martial theory basically does not apply in here. Right? Even though it was a part of the discourse on the British Indian Army, in here we cannot really see it. It's just Indians, and we can't call, through the martial race theory, we can't call all Indians martial, just some ethnic groups. And here, if the Polish people do not really distinguish between those martial groups, then it's very difficult to say anything about the presence of the martial race theory. But moving on, they are frequently portrayed in non-military roles. So they are drivers, medical staff, and cooks. They are very friendly and professional. It hardly happens that somebody complains or has got some issues with the Indians. But basically, this martial race theory does not really apply. This expert, which you can see on the right, is the only one that talks about some sort of martiality, possibly, of Indians. So there is a comparison between an Indian soldier and the Carpathian Brigade, which Jelita Czerkawski was a part of, and that's it. This is the only one, which is a little bit sad if you think about it. Only one martial reference to the Indians. What appears mostly are these sort of descriptions regarding the situation, a non-military situation. So something about cooking, because many Indians were chefs, apparently. Some people were happy with their way of cooking, some people were unhappy about the way of cooking. So here the description varies depending on, you know, the personality of the author. So it's very difficult to find something, to decide something on that. And then we have got a very nice course in here at the bottom, regarding the first day, perhaps the first, really the first encounter after the evacuation from the Soviet Union, where the soldiers were welcomed the Poles were welcomed by the Indians in the port of Pahlevi, and they were basically, the Indians were pretty much the first people whom they encountered, the first soldiers whom they encountered as well, because they had never had before any experience with the Indians. That's why I have found a lot of references to that moment when the Poles arrived at Pahlevi, because the Indians were something new, perhaps something exotic. They've never had anything to do with them before, so that's why reference to that moment can be frequently found in the memoir. To conclude, since I haven't got my notes, so I go through the presentation faster than I would have done otherwise. To conclude, there is a significant difference in the portrayal of the Gurkhas and the Indians through the lens of martiality, as I have managed to prove. And the perception of the South Asians depends on the kind of role they perform in the army, with regards, of course, to the Polish World War II memoir, because if a random person takes these memoirs to their hands and they start reading them, they will see exactly what I saw. The Gurkhas are extremely professional, soldiery, manly people, while Indians basically drive and cook, and they are not necessarily skilled when it comes to war, which is not exactly true when it comes to martial race theory. I noticed also that there is a little tiny difference when it comes to the authors who know English and those who did not know English. Those who are familiar with the English language, they were also more familiar with the concept of martiality. So it was easy to see. And this made me conclude that basically this martial race theory was spreading through the English language. In a way. So it was present within the British Army, and this is how it was reaching to the Polish soldiers who were also a part of it. And this is what I assume. And then overall, the Poles, of course, contribute to the building of the image of the Gurkhas as a warrior race, because we cannot deny the fact that they were familiar to a certain extent with that theory. And I think I would complete my presentation in here, and thank you for your presence, and hopefully also for your interest. Thank you very much indeed.
I would like to say thank you for all the presentations. All of them were really interesting. Like, if anyone has some questions to the presentation of the other panelists, please, this is the time for asking. So maybe someone has some questions.
Yeah, if I could ask one question to Beata and one question to Paulina. So of course, both presentations were really interesting, really enlightening. And the first one to Dr. Beata, what is, because you were talking about some kind of digital divisions in India. So I would like to ask, what is the central government of local government strategy to combat these digital divisions in India? Of course, if there is any strategy. And to Paulina, about Gurkhas, because I have some technical difficulties at the beginning of your presentation. So I would like to ask you, are there still some Gurkhas troops in the British Army? And it's all. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so perhaps Beata?
Oh, no, we can first.
Okay, sorry. Thank you very much for your question. Yes, there are Gurkhas still in the British Army. If you would like to know more, there is an article, I think it was published in 2019 or 2018, when in that article I basically elaborate on the situation of the Gurkhas in the British Army for now, because the history of the of their presence after the Second World War is really, really interesting. There were really a lot of changes. Basically, most of the Gurkhas were sort of removed from the army after the British left Hong Kong because they were not useful anymore. So the brigade, the whole, the size was really, really reduced. And they were left, I think they left about 2,000 soldiers in total. And then the parliament was debating whether we should keep them at all, because what's the point of keeping 2,000 soldiers, right? And to train them and to everything, it was a lot of cost. So there is a lot of debate. There was a lot of debate at that stage. But then they realized that the model of warfare also internationally started to change, because I think the cutout date was the early 2000s. But then we had the started the war on terror after September 11, and that changed the whole point. Basically, the British Army at that stage realized that we need mobile units. So because the war is not going to be a total war like the First World War or the Second World War anymore, we don't need a gigantic army, but we need small skilled units which can be basically sent, dispatched very easily to different parts of the world as a part of the British Army. So if it wasn't for September 11, I think that the situation of the Gurkhas might have been very different. But at that moment, they decided to keep the brigade as it was, and they started using those units around the world, not in peacekeeping operations, because that's not really according to the international law, because you shouldn't be using soldiers of a different nationality within your own peacekeeping troops. So they're basically spending their time mostly on training, but they have been present in Afghanistan as well. Right now, they're number has been growing as well. They have expanded the recruitment base as well. This is something that perhaps 10 or 15 years ago they would have never anticipated. There is because there nobody wants to serve in the British Army. They have a problem recruiting their own people. So basically they have recruiting problems basically. So they decided to have more Gurkhas and more Gurkhas. So right now this number, I think they recruit about 100 and something a year from Nepal, and then they are trained in the United Kingdom, not in Nepal. And this number has been growing. Like they add every year, they add like 10, 20 to that general number that they recruit. So it's a really, really interesting process. Right now, they even started recruiting female Nepali soldiers, if I may put it this way. So this is also an enormous change. I don't think I have mentioned that in my article because it was produced in 2018, so I didn't really have the most recent data. But if you want to get a general overview, it was published in Anglica. If you find it, I encourage you to have a look at that if this is something that interests you, because it's really, really interesting subject to look at, and these are things that are normally not being discussed. I hope that it answered your question.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Sorry, can you repeat your question, because I started to hear Paulina Stanik, and can you repeat one more time your question?
Sure. So what is the central government in India or local government strategy to combat this digital divisions in in India? Of course, if there is any strategy to combat this problem.
In my opinion, there is no strategy, because in my opinion, first you have to fight with illiteracy. If your parent is illiteracy and your parent can't help you in doing your homework, Yes, and you can only give your mobile to children to see what is your homework. So I think that this is no strategy, because now there is no link between teachers, between local, for example, government, and teachers don't want to participate in this education. So this is the problem, because they have no connection with their pupils. I think that so many people will never return to school after pandemic. And this is the main problem in India, because now there is a community spread of coronavirus. We don't talk about this in Poland, but my husband, who came from Bikaner in Rajasthan, he is in touch with so many Indians, and they explained him that there is no really education, because there is so many teachers who has coronavirus, so they don't think about their education, their lessons, their pupils, they take care of their family. This is their priority. So now education, this is not priority for everybody. So if your parents are not, they don't know how to use the internet, they cannot to use even computer, so they use only mobile. And for example, now there is in every railway, they have a connection with internet. But if you have lockdown and you can go anywhere, so you cannot to use this internet. This so, for in my opinion, there is no strategy how to fight with this. So maybe this is the answer. Okay. I think that they have another priority than education.
Mm-hmm. Sure, okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you all for your discussion and the presentation. I think that everyone had chance to present their presentation. So now it's time to say thank you and finish this panel. So once again, thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Goodbye.